Well, Saskatchewan is in the red. Yesterday, Finance Minister Donna Harfauer released this year's budget, and the province is projecting a $273.2 million deficit.
Do we have a spending problem? I would categorize it more of expense pressures due to the growing province. So, you know, it is definitely record investment in education and healthcare. Both of which I feel the timing needs to be, I feel it needs to be done at this point in time. We do have a growing population and we perhaps aren't getting the revenues from that growth. We will into the future to help sustain the increases that we put, but we undoubtedly have more kids in our classrooms. We have to build schools, we have to build classrooms, and we have to put more resources in our classrooms. We have more people coming through the doors of our healthcare facilities. And so, you know, it is the growth that comes, then you get the economic benefit of that comes right after. So I think that I'm comfortable with those decisions that we've made for this budget. I think the timing is now where we need to invest in services for people. And I'm also very comfortable and confident that our economy will support it and it will be sustainable into the future.
But not everyone thinks it is sustainable. Trent Weatherspoon is the finance critic for the NDP.
The fact that the SAS party failed to provide any cost of living relief in this budget tells you everything you need to know about the SAS party and this budget. No fuel tax relief. No cuts to their massive hikes to PST that hits families so hard, taking more and more money every year. In fact, for a family this year, they're taking $1,500 more this year on the PST than before they brought those hikes forward. Not only that, we continue to see a government that is ignoring the solutions brought forward by healthcare workers and those who know their communities best. No plan for a nursing task force to address the issues of recruitment and retention, despite new numbers yesterday showing the majority of new healthcare grads are leaving the province. No plans to fix ambulance services to reduce pressures in our emergency rooms or to make sure that an ambulance is there when you call 911. No plan to work with local communities and healthcare workers on a grow your own retention strategy. No plans to implement more primary care. Increased spending is one thing, but we need to be talking about how we can spend better, not just more.
And so today on Blue Sky, we'll be talking to people across this province about how the budget is going to affect their lives. And we want to hear from you, too. What stands out to you from what you see so far or don't see in this budget? You can call us at 1-800-716-2221 or email bluesky@cbc.ca. Our guest for the hour today is Tom McIntosh. He's a professor in the Department of Politics and International Studies at the University of Regina, and he joins us right now. Tom, hello. Welcome to Blue Sky.
Thanks. Great to be here.
Yeah, it's great to have you as a guest today to help us make sense of all of this. We do have several guests later in the show who will be speaking about healthcare, about the situation in some northern communities. We've got a guest from Pinehouse joining us later on the show. But I want to start by asking you about the deficit. How significant is this?
Well, I think it's particularly significant in that this was supposed to be, if I remember, $1 billion surplus this year. So there's a significant difference between that and a $250 million or so deficit. I think a bigger concern is, you know, in and of itself, that's not a huge deficit, but insofar as it continues to increase the sort of overall provincial debt, which is getting more and more expensive to service as interest rates have gone up. That's going to be a growing concern, I think, for future governments.
How did we get here? What happened to cause this flip going from a $1 billion surplus to this deficit?
Well, the finance minister this morning talked about, a number of things like the crop insurance payments and all of that, that all had to be reflected. And fair enough, you know, things happen to governments that they weren't expecting or accounting for. But I would also suggest that in a world with a changing climate, that things like projecting how much you may have to pay out in crop insurance may need to begin to reflect some of those things that were no long, that what we may have in Saskatchewan, in fact, is something of what you might call a new normal in terms of our experiences with drought and the like, all of which needs to go into government forecasts. And that's, it seems, where the government fell down a little in their ability to forecast. And again, not a huge criticism on my part, but rather saying, you know, this is hard stuff to do. And so, you know, governments need to be more and more cautious in how they go about those kinds of even year over year forecasting.
Yeah, and I agree that this is hard stuff, and I'm definitely, I've never done a budget like this, but when I hear money going to crop insurance payments, my mind right away goes to, well, what about this coming year and the concerns about a drought? And so is there anything in this budget that helps plan for the year ahead?
I'm not sure that there is. I'm not sure that much has changed in the way they're doing their forecasting. If you look at the projected deficits and then the slow move back to a small surplus, it's going to take a few years. Those could also be knocked sideways if we have a couple more years of really bad drought and a variety of other types of things. You know, forest fires can eat up a huge cost if they, if we have a summer like we've had in the past, or if we have a summer that like BC had last year. All of those things are contingencies that you can't predict, but you do have to learn how to plan for them.
I want to ask you a bit about revenue. And so one thing that the finance minister said is that we're not seeing the revenue yet from growth. And so I'm curious about your thoughts on that. And then we'll talk about where we are getting revenue from right now. So maybe if you could speak to growth and her comments are that we're just not seeing the revenue from that growth yet.
Yeah, that's an interesting thing, and you probably need a more full-fledged economist than I am to get too down into the weeds on that. But again, it does raise some questions if the economy is growing and the province is growing, the population is growing, there should be at some point revenue coming from that, those levels of growth. Some of that may have to do with, are we growing in the sort of high productivity kind of areas that we need to be growing in, or are we growing in, in a low wage kind of economy? We do have one of the lowest minimum wages in the country. If that's where the growth in jobs is, that's not going to contribute large amounts to the growth in the economy.
When you say,
or put much in terms of government revenue.
Yeah, and then on the flip side, what would be an example of a higher productivity?
Or higher productivity or higher wage jobs, is the growth happening in, again, the agricultural sector is hurting. I wouldn't suspect that that's going to be where you're going to see it. Are you seeing it in other kinds of innovative job creation or in sort of higher wage, well-paying jobs?
So where is the government getting its revenue from?
Well, it's always a mix of personal income tax, corporate income tax, both of which are down this year, and then of course, good old-fashioned federal transfers. There's roughly a third of the budget or so comes from federal transfers. Most notably, of course, is the health transfer, but also the social transfer and a variety of other smaller transfers for various bits and pieces between the federal government and the provinces.
What about the opposition's argument that there was no relief from the fuel tax or any kind of PST relief? What do you think is the thinking there on the government's part? And then, of course, the criticism that comes from the opposition on that.
It is interesting. A colleague of mine on CBC sort of suggested there was something odd of the right of center government spending more than it's ever spent in the past, and the left of center opposition calling for tax cuts and the like. Leaving aside the sort of maybe what some people might see as ideological inconsistencies, I think that's one of the things that characterizes this budget, is that there is a lot of spending. There's a lot of spending that I would also say is, you know, catch-up spending and necessary spending, especially in terms on the capital side and the building, the hospital infrastructure and the like, all of which is I think needed. Same with the schools and whatnot. It's not clear to me that in an election year, that's the kind of spending that changes voting intentions, because it's not putting money directly into your pocket the way, say, a cut to the PST would, a cut to the gas tax would, and the like. That's a more traditional way of doing an election year budget. So this is sort of a high spending budget without a lot of individual goodies that people are going to see directly. They're going to see it sort of indirectly. They may see it in their community with a new hospital, a new school in their neighborhood, but they won't see it in terms of their own bank balance.
I have one more question related to that before we get to a caller. So if the opposition is calling or had hoped for a break on the fuel tax, I wonder if you can just help people make sense, because they might be hearing these things like, okay, so the Saskatchewan Party, our government, okay with the fuel tax, but they're sure mad about the carbon tax. And if we're focused on the cost of living, can you just help people understand what we might be paying out of pocket? They serve different purposes, but just in terms of affordability, can you put that in context a bit?
In terms of the affordability issue, the simple fact is it doesn't really matter to the public where the fuel tax goes to or what it's exactly for. In fact, it's hard to say what it's for, because all of the revenue just goes into a single pot. Anyway, we don't really deal much in the way of earmarked kinds of taxes. But every time, you would notice you would notice the change in gasoline prices were that tax to be lowered. You'd notice it if the PST came down. And you're talking about, that's the government foregoing revenue that then has to make up from elsewhere. But we're talking, hundreds of millions of dollars probably in foregone revenue. But that's revenue then that stays in an individual person's bank account.
Right. Okay. We're going to talk about healthcare in a moment, but first I want to bring in a caller on the line. So Warren in Gray joins us on the line right now. Hi, Warren.
Good afternoon. We've just been seeming to go in debt farther and farther. I mean, every government seems to bring us into debt farther, but the last 17 years that we've had the SAS party, 17 years ago, I think we were about $10.4 billion in debt. Now we haven't doubled it. We've actually tripled it. We now are like $34 billion in debt. And, a lot of the services have been cut, STC, schools obviously now are suffering, and, gotten to a point where wages really are not the issue. It's complexity and things like that. So And sales tax, one time it was 5%, now it's 6%. And it's not only the increase in the sales tax, it's what it's applied to. So insurance, which it never was before, used vehicles, which it never was before. I just have a hard time finding why we keep reelecting the SAS party, to be quite honest.
Warren, I appreciate you calling today with your thoughts. Thank you.
Thank you, too. Bye now.
It's Warren and Gray. You can call us, too, 1-800-716-2221. You can also email bluesky@cbc.ca. Now, Tom, I want to switch the conversation to focus on healthcare for a bit here, because healthcare spending is always a pretty big one. And this year, the provincial government is dedicating $7.6 billion in healthcare spending. That's a 10.6% increase from last year. A chunk of that money is going to capital projects, including $188 million to redevelop the Victoria Hospital in Prince Albert, $55 million to replace the Weyburn General Hospital, $27 million for the long-term care project in LaRonde, and $20 million for long-term special care beds in Regina. Now, Bashir Jello says the money needs to be spent on the people power to run these facilities. He's president of CUPE, that's the union that represents healthcare workers with the Saskatchewan Health Authority. He spoke to our political affairs reporter, Adam Hunter, in the Rotunda following yesterday's budget.
What we see in this budget, there's been quite a lot of talk about recruitment and retention before in the past. But we have not seen that coming to fruition completely. I mean, even in the budget today, they only talk about 262 people did train to come and about 40 for international. But nothing, there's nothing, I was listening, I saw nothing about retention. Now we've heard very clearly they talk about buildings in the province. We have the urgent care facility that is being built in Regina. But right now they are struggling to staff that building. That's a huge investment. And the best way you're going to be able to attract people in healthcare is to work on retention. If you just let people come in without allowing them to stay, that is no use to us. So if you are going to build big building, build this building. But you have to be able to staff it. And one of the reasons how you can staff those buildings is to work on retention. Retention meaning try to work to improve the work environment. We've had the same processes promises before. We heard about this I've been coming here for 3 years now. We heard about the 300 that was promised about CCAs about 3 years ago. And up till now, we go around this province. Go to the long-term care facilities. These people are overstaffed. So yes, we can build buildings, which is great. Yes, we do appreciate the 4.5% increase in healthcare, but you have to focus on retention. We also heard the federal government giving some money, and we have been here before. We saw during the pandemic, the federal government gave money, but that money did not flow to frontline. We are looking forward to see this money going to the frontline services. That is the only way that is going to make a difference in this province.
Yeah, you're referencing the money that was announced earlier this week, the federal transfer, $560 million. And there's 300 plus million there, and it was, different areas where they're focusing. One was on recruitment and retention. What do you need to see from the health minister, from the two health ministers, as far as how that money is going to flow into, as you mentioned, frontline care?
Number one, focus on retention. They have always been focusing off recruitment, and it's been very reactive. That is, there is a crisis here. Let's go outside and hire, bring people to come in. But we have seen that. They've also talked about recruitment and bringing people from other provinces into here. But those people, when they come, when they realize that the pay in this province is lower compared to Western Canada provinces, they are leaving. I can tell you these classifications. And they talk about this. In this budget, I heard they talk about $5.1 million for medical imaging. I listened to that. It's great. They talk about an improvement in funding to keep breast cancer assessment in this province. We saw that. How are you going to do that? The only way you're going to do that is no magic, is to have staff. But if you cannot staff that, if you cannot do anything to retain people, those, like, who are the people that do this breast assessment clinic in this province? We have the MRTs that do that. But those MRTs, if you look at the salary across Western Canada, Manitoba, Alberta, and British Columbia, the wages are much higher. They bring people in when they are new, they are graduating from school. But then once they get 2 or 3 years behind their belt, they are leaving. So the most, what we want to see now, we want to see a focus on recruitment and retention and also improving the work environment in these places.
Jello, the president of QPE, the union that represents healthcare workers with the Saskatchewan Health Authority. You are listening to Blue Sky. We're taking a closer look at the provincial budget, and our guest today is Tom McIntosh. He's in the Department of Politics and International Studies at the University of Regina. We hope you will join the conversation with your own reaction to the budget. 1-800-716-2221. You can also email bluesky@cbc.ca. I will be asking Tom about his reaction to the health spending, but let's first check in with David Shield, who joins us right now. David, what's making news?
Well, as you've been hearing, reaction continues to come in after yesterday's provincial budget. The Saskatchewan Health Authority says record health spending will help hospital overcrowding and wait times. There's also $500 million allocated for hospital and care home construction. People in Saskatoon who bought food or beverages at a Shoppers Drug Mart could be at risk of hepatitis A exposure. The alert is between February 27th and March 19th. Anyone who may be affected is asked to call 811. And Mary Brown says everyone should swim. Brown is 94 years old and the oldest competitive swimmer in the province. She still takes part in swim meets and says people who retire have to keep moving. And I'll have a full newscast for you coming up at 1 o'clock.
David, thank you.
You're welcome.
That is the CBC's David Shield. I'm Lisa Gravinsky. This is Blue Sky on CBC Radio 1. The number to call today to join the conversation about the budget is 1-800-716-2221. You can also email bluesky@cbc.ca. Tom McIntosh is our guest today, a politics professor. Tom, we were just talking about healthcare. We heard from the president of QPE, the union that represents healthcare workers with the Saskatchewan Health Authority. In his conversation there with the CBC's Adam Hunter, they referenced the healthcare transfers from the federal government that were announced earlier this week. That's $560 million. What can you tell us about that?
Well, this comes from the agreement, if you want to call it that, last February, in which the federal government outlined to the provinces how much money it was going to give in health transfers, plus what additional money over and above the regular CHT they would be willing to give over the next number of years. Each province was then charged with signing a bilateral agreement for their share of the healthcare funding, and this is money divided up on a per capita basis across the provinces. And it took a year, but this week we signed our bilateral agreement to get the money. Within that bilateral agreement, and I haven't had much of a chance yet to look at it in any detail, you will see where they agree or where the province says they are going to allocate and spend, in particular, the additional money, some of which is, as the president of QPE was talking about, aimed at recruitment and retention issues within the healthcare system.
Because before we got to the QPE president, I listed off all of the capital projects, and of course, infrastructure is expensive. They've set aside $180 million for the expansion of Victoria Hospital in Prince Albert. The total of that project is expected to cost $898 million. Even the parkade at Regina General is expected to cost $22 million. So what are your thoughts on these pretty expensive projects?
You know, one of the things, well, part of this is, again, over the course of the last few decades, as health spending has become a perennially intense issue between the federal government and the provinces, one of the ways in which provinces have managed their healthcare dollars is to defer a lot of capital spending in the healthcare sector. The health infrastructure in Canada is aging and is in desperate need of the kind of investments that are in the budget. So I'm, as a health policy guy, this is important money. It is not a substitute for fixing what's wrong inside the system. but it is important that the system have an infrastructure that is up to date and can and as modern as possible. So I have no problem with the capital spending. What I would really like to see is a detailed plan on moving the system towards better primary health care, more team-based care, the integration of new professions like physician assistants and nurse practitioners and the like. It's not just about recruitment intention and retention of doctors and nurses. You cannot isolate one part of the health human resource equation and say we're going to focus on, you know, making more family docs. You have to think about it in terms of how many family docs do you need if you also increase or triple the, say, the number of nurse practitioners. Well, you might actually be able to get away with fewer family docs if you can replace them in some way with nurse practitioners. So you have to take that kind of holistic picture. And that's what not just this provincial government, but I think all provincial governments are struggling with, the fact that it has so many moving pieces and parts.
I want to hone in here for a moment on the cancer care budget, because it will increase by 11%. The Saskatchewan Cancer Agency will receive an increase of $26.1 million to bring its budget to $249 million. This will include $3.5 million to establish Regina's new breast assessment center. But our next guest is wondering who will work in that center. Lisa Vick is a mother of two from Weyburn. She waited months after finding a lump on her breast before she was able to get treatment, and she's now recovering at home after getting a bilateral mastectomy, a double mastectomy, on March 5th, and that's where we've reached her today. Lisa, hello.
Hello.
First off, I want to know how you're doing. How's your recovery going?
Good so far.
Quite the journey, though, that you've been on. It's been quite the journey, yeah. So when you listen to politicians talk about the budget and the amount spent on healthcare, I'm just wondering, what is the first thing that comes to mind for you after everything you've been through?
I guess peace of mind to start. Obviously, it's too late for me that this breast assessment center is coming. But going forward for the future of other women in this province who have yet to be diagnosed or, you know, are just starting that diagnosis process, that, you know, there'll be a facility that will house everything all in one spot for them, and hopefully that their diagnosis process can go a lot faster than mine did.
Because the last time you spoke to CBC, you had been waiting months for a diagnosis after finding a lump on your breast, and you had to travel to Calgary for a biopsy. Where did you end up having your surgery?
I was did have my surgery in Regina. It was just that the wait for the biopsy, even though I was a BI-RADS 5, which is 95% chance or higher of malignancy, and it was classified as urgent, the wait was just, you know, it was too long, and I was moved up on the list, and I was offered the opportunity to go to Calgary to receive that biopsy. And so, yes, I did travel to Calgary for that. And but then everything was done in Regina.
The waiting, though, what was that like for you?
Oh, it's terrible. I started, like, I found my lump at the end of September, called my family physician, and it was a one-month wait just to even get into my family physician, which, you know, is everyone is struggling. You know, we have over 200,000 people in the province by the sounds of it that don't even have access to a family physician. Luckily, I mentioned that I had had a lump. They got me into another doctor who started the process for me, but that was a two-month wait to get in for a mammogram.
So the fact that we've in the budget, this does include money to establish Regina's new breast assessment center. Your experience shines a light on issues beyond just that facility. The difficulty in finding a family doctor is kind of the start of it all.
Well, yeah, it's my hold up again is, you know, the radiologist is where the issue is, right? We do have a breast assessment center in Regina, but there was a lack of radiologists. There's just was not enough of them at the time to, you know, see all these women that have lumps or even yearly mammograms scheduled. I mean, women are waiting over a year just to have a yearly mammogram. It's unacceptable.
And does anything that you've read so far assure you that things will shift?
No, the trust has been broken. I've heard, you know, we're working on it. You know, we've got all this money. We're working on recruitment and retention. The radiologists are coming. But, you know, for me, it was a choice. Like, I could have kept my healthy breast, but I decided not to because I couldn't take the chance of going through that again and putting my family through that wait again. It's just, it's unbearable and it's unnecessary. Like, there's other provinces that are getting, you know, their proper breast care for their women. Why are we so far behind? I mean, I'm excited for the province as well that, you know, they're lowering the age of mammograms to 40 for women, which might have helped me in my case because I did find out that I had very dense breast tissue, which is also an indicator of higher risk for breast cancer. So, I mean, that's, something that's positive as well. But again, recruitment and retention. Who is going to run these facilities?
Will you continue to advocate? Will you have the energy to advocate? What do you think lies ahead for you when it comes to trying to influence some change?
Oh, absolutely. I will advocate because I will admit I was naive to the state of the breast care that in our province and also just breast health in general for myself. Like, I have no family history. I'm an overall healthy 48-year-old woman at the time. And I had no idea about dense breasts and, you know, and just a few other things that I've learned. And having to advocate for myself to make sure my file was getting put to the right place, you know, appointments were being, you know, taken care of, calling the breast assessment center to see, you know, where I was on this urgent list. And a lot of women just aren't capable or they don't know where to go. And I want to help, you know, be a voice and to, you know, see some more action on this and make sure that women are having access to the life-saving care that they need.
Lisa, thank you for joining us today. I really appreciate it.
Thanks for having me.
That is Lisa Vick. She's recovering at home in Weyburn after a double mastectomy. The 48-year-old mother of two had to wait months for a diagnosis and then had to go to Calgary for a biopsy before finally getting surgery in Regina. You're listening to Blue Sky. Today we're taking a closer look at the provincial budget. We've got Tom McIntosh with us, professor in the Department of Politics and International Studies at the University of Regina. And we hope you'll join the conversation too, 1-800-716-2221 or email bluesky@cbc.ca. Let's go to Nicole, who joins us on the line right now in Saskatoon. Hi, Nicole.
Hi. Thanks for having me.
What's your take on the budget?
Well, when I listened this morning to Donna Hartpower talking specifically about social services, I thought it was very interesting. I'm a SED recipient myself. I used to be a very high-functioning working individual, and then I had a work injury, and life has taken quite a turn since. And so I have gone through an experience of being top of my class, university student, bursary recipient, management, to a social assistance recipient. And I will tell you that the experience has been very eye-opening. It has led me down some roads to advocacy. I ended up in meetings with the Minister of Social Services approximately 3 years ago, and we were bringing up concerns at that point about lack of increases to SED, which is Saskatchewan Assured Income for people living with disabilities. There had been no increase since 2015. And so, of course, there's been a small increase last year. There's an increase this year, but I think it's a little bit too late. And I think that such healthcare and education, there's been a lot more talk and media coverage. Social services seems to be an area where there's so many people falling through the cracks, and there seems to be a lot of lack of accountability. So just one example, when there was changes with SIF coming in instead of SAP, back in 2019, I was living at a property rental which dominates the market for low-income housing, and the ministry lost my paperwork twice, which I had submitted, and I was then being threatened with eviction and then, you know, given a late fee. And I was just very fortunate at the time to know someone who knew someone at a nonprofit, who knew someone else at a nonprofit, who was able to reach out to my call-off worker. And then finally, when my paperwork was received, I I was acknowledged. But what I find is that people in positions such as mine are given, are presumed to be non-credible and ignored a lot. And we're living in poverty, and that experience is also very traumatizing. What I hear from the Minister of Finance is a lot of dialogue about people need to utilize programs to get back to work. And part of my question to her is, what happens when you are unable to work? Because most people on social assistance, whether it be SED or SIS, are living with disabilities. And I think, considering how much homelessness has become such a prominent discussion in our city, such as Saskatoon, I think the populace and voters need to take a real look at the decisions of this provincial government. At that same time, when I was able to attend that meeting with Laura Carr when she was the Minister of Social Services, we were asking for a raise to SED rates, explaining a number of frontline workers who work with disability population that people are having to choose between paid rent or getting medications. And sadly, her response to us, I was quite shocked by this, was that we were not the worst in the country and the federal government was doing something. That was when inflation was just starting to rise. And so I think a lot of the crisis we've seen in terms of housing and that we're really seeing pop up on our streets does relate to those social programs. And we need to take into consideration if the market rates and what people are being given doesn't match, say, the cost of rent, and you're also capped on how much you can earn and save on something like SED, you're in what's called legislated poverty. And have faced a lot of barriers to work, it's a very difficult situation to be in.
Sorry, Nicole, I just wanted to jump in so that people know that the Saskatchewan Income Support and Saskatchewan Assured Income for Disability Benefits are rising by 3%. I just wanted people to hear and be clear on the amount it's rising by this year. 3% for you, yep. Nicole, does that make a difference? And you use the words too late, a 3% increase. What impact does that have?
Well, I will mimic what I heard from the last caller, that the trust has been broken. 3% helps. But it doesn't take away from the years of stress. I honestly think that if I had been more properly supported, I might have been able to get into the workplace earlier. And my health has declined so much that it's getting tougher and tougher. But that's not relating to disability. That's relating to the experience of poverty. And when you are living in so low and in often unsafe housing conditions, it takes a real toll. So,
Are you living in unsafe housing conditions?
I fortunately have been able to get out of it now, but when I lived in that property management, which, like I say, dominates the market, I had bed bugs for a year. I had the gang activity I had to deal with, the abuse next door, mailbox break-ins, and I wasn't even in the worst areas of our city. And so, part of my question to the provincial government, too, is are you looking at your policies for renters to hold some of the powerful corporations who dominate the housing market to account in the way that they're treating tenants?
Nicole, I appreciate you calling today, sharing your story and raising some questions. Thank you so much for being part of the conversation.
Thank you very much.
It's Nicole joining us in Saskatoon. Our guest today is Tom McIntosh. Tom, you've been listening, and we're going to talk more about the housing situation, the money available to people on assistance. Tom, what's your just initial reaction to the numbers, but then also to some of the stories we've heard?
Well, both of those stories were, the real life impacts of various decisions that have been taken. It is interesting in terms of the woman recovering from breast cancer. You know, when we started to really get a concern about wait times in this country, which is about 25 years ago, it was always about non-acute kinds of services. It was always, you know, elective surgeries, and that was where the backlogs were and whatnot. Now we're seeing sort of these growing waits in the kinds of services that people should not have to wait for, right? You should not have to wait for a cancer diagnosis if the system is functioning properly. I think the new center that's being built in Regina is a massive improvement. It is coming too late, but we should not have wound up in a situation where we were sending people to Calgary for those kinds of treatments. The social assistance, it is one of the perennial issues. You know, health, education, various other things always do get a great deal of attention, in large part because those are the concerns of middle-class residents who are the ones who go out and vote and who actually have the most or some of the loudest political voices. The people who live on the margins, the people who live in poverty, are the ones without much voice. And so they're the ones who quite often fail to get heard in any way.
Yeah, you know, related to that, Tom, I just want to interject for a second because the mental health and addictions budget is $574 billion. So that's more than 7% of the total health budget. And if you read the comments section on Scott Moe's Facebook page, you'll see that there are many of his supporters who don't want anything spent on mental health and addictions. So does that spending surprise you?
The spending is incredibly needed. We have a huge addictions problem, not just in this province, but growing across the country and growing in all sorts of horrible ways. But neither does the reaction to some people that, you know, this is not money that is worth spending. I don't know what to say to them other than to ask them where their empathy is for people who are struggling. I work a lot in the area of and have done a lot of work on things like mental health issues and the like. And it is incredibly encouraging to see this move slowly, but move towards the center of our conversation around health. And it has changed, you know, and that's a good thing. And all governments, I think, should be applauded for that, to the extent that we are at least talking about this in a way we never talked about it when I started as a health policy guy 25 years ago.
On that note, I want to bring in someone else to the conversation. So Kimberly Smith is health and wellness manager with Kennebec Métis Local, and she's in Pinehouse. Kimberly, welcome to Blue Sky.
Hi, good afternoon.
I'm wondering, for someone like yourself in Pinehouse, what's your reaction to the budget?
I'm excited for parts of the infrastructure and addressing some of the increases, even though they're very minimal. What I think is the budget's the budget. We can have a lot of opinions on it, but what it filters down to the actual residents of Saskatchewan, which is the whole province, not just a couple of cities in Saskatchewan, that a lot more work is needed in addressing some of these complex issues.
Tell me more about that, because we've just been talking about money being allocated for mental health. But from in Pinehouse, what are you seeing when it comes to issues like housing, like substance use disorder?
Yeah, so my job is I deal with homeless population, and I also deal a lot with mental health and addictions. I operate a land-based wellness camp as well as a homeless shelter, so it's really, they're very tied together. And from our experiences, a lot of the resources are spent in the three major cities in the province, with a lot less care and attention going to rural and remote communities. And speaking on behalf of Pinehouse, we've been doing like decades of work in trying to progress our programs and have them be funded. So a lot of communities don't have what we have because we're not building them up. When you talk about homelessness and the money that's going to Regina, the money that's going to Saskatoon, and I would like to see the demographics of some of the residents that they have there. Where are they from? Are they primarily from rural remote communities? Are they directly from Saskatoon and Regina areas? And if it's mostly Indigenous people, are rural and remote people, are people in other parts of the province, that some of the funding needs to be filtered down to the communities so that it can start to address at the base level, at the ground level, some of the issues that take them from these places into those centralized communities.
There is one budget item that I know people in your community are quite excited about, the announcement of money going towards a new school. Do you want to tell me about the reaction to that?
That one is so exciting. Like I said, we're grateful for some of the infrastructure that we're getting for the school. It's been, you know, a decade-long battle that our leadership, our high school and elementary admin have been fighting for. A lot of northern, rural, and remote communities are facing issues with aging infrastructure. And when it comes to that, again, there's dollars allotted to southern places in terms of homelessness and education. But I think it's much needed, much necessary, and I hope that it's a start, that people start to see how our community was fighting for this money and we got it, but the need is so huge in so many other communities. But we're very grateful. We work as an interagency here in our community where all agencies get together, we all talk. So this has been a topic that we've discussed multiple times. We've done a lot of prep work and we're really excited to see what we can do to maximize this new build to ensure that all community agencies can be part of the growth and continue on from there.
Yeah, because even as a health and wellness manager who's focused on housing and addictions, you see this a new school as a real central location to gather and to really build community, right?
Oh, for sure. And to see what other programs can go into the new school or complement the new school or start to increase with their programming, then that also opens up other infrastructure for, say, if services go into the school that are community-led, then that kind of opens up other locations where some of our programs can run out of. Like, again, most other rural and northern communities, there's an issue with infrastructure, the lack of the age and date of them, and unability. Like, for my office, in the 3 years that I've been here, I've gone from one staff to 24 staff. And we can't sustain that growth with the lack of office space, even in a lot of our communities. So it's exciting that we get to build more with what we're getting.
Okay. Well, Kimberly, thank you so much for being with us today. I appreciate it.
Thank you, guys.
That is Kimberly Smith, Health and Wellness Manager with Kinepik Métis Local in Pine House. Now, Tom, we need to do another show on education spending. And I'm embarrassed that I'm giving you hardly any time to talk about this. It's obviously such a big issue right now. But the amount for capital spending on education, do you want to just kind of wrap things up with commenting on what we're seeing in terms of that kind of spending?
Well, again, I think this is... This is necessary spending. It's spending that's been delayed for a number of years, and it's the kind of infrastructure that, you know, has to be continually renewed.
And I guess one of the questions people have, you know, and I can understand all arguments, a lot of money going to build schools, but what about what's happening inside of schools, right? And have they struck the right balance?
And that's true, but, you know, the governments have to be able to walk and chew gum, right? You have to be able to do both, keep the infrastructure healthy and alive, and it is, in fact, about... In fact, health, because it does impact students' health. And you also have to make sure there are good qualified teachers who have the necessary supports that they need in order to teach effectively. It is about walking and chewing gum at the same time. And so one should never be pitted against the other. You have to do both. What seems to happen is that governments choose to do one or the other.
Because teachers were picketing outside the legislature as the budget was being released.
Well, exactly. And, you know, we're in the midst of this sort of set of rotating, moving strike action by teachers. We still have a serious issue that this government needs to resolve with teachers in this province. The infrastructure, I don't think anybody is complaining about it. It doesn't solve the other half of the equation.
And so the conversation continues, Tom. It's been a pleasure having you today. We'll do it again.
It's always fun.
Take care, Tom. That's Tom.
And thanks for this.
Yeah, take care. That's Tom McIntosh, professor in the Department of Politics and International Studies at the University of Regina. I'm Leisha Grabinski. This is Blue Sky on CBC Radio 1. Thanks to everyone who called. If you missed out, give us a ring on TalkBack, 1-800-661-7540.